February 26th, 2023. I can no longer tell what elements of this map are my friends, which are mine, and what the map has created. I am no longer afraid that the map is creating itself. It needs me as much as I need it.
MyHouse.WAD is one of the wildest, most ambitious horror projects I've ever seen. Despite its advertised runtime of 10 minutes, escaping the horrors within requires hours, days, or even weeks of experimentation. My House creates horror by treating the player with cruelty, utilizing liminal spaces, inhospitable map design, and dogs. Bah. The mod features themes of trauma, grief, and isolation. MyHouse.WAD has a little nightmare for everyone. Meanwhile, the map delivers the story of Steve Nelson, who descends into madness as he struggles to cope with the death of his closest childhood friend. I'm gonna go ahead and give you one small spoiler here at the beginning. Steve is hiding a secret, one that changes everything you're going to see. And if you want to find out what it is, you're gonna need to dive into madness right alongside him. Before we get into it, I implore you, play this map yourself. Playing through the map unspoiled is an experience I don't want to take away from any of you. I'll leave a link in the description if you'd like to try it for yourself, and with that out of the way, I welcome you to my house. The earliest version of myhouse.wad was shared quite innocuously on the Doomworld forums on September 2nd, 2022, before its full release 6 months later. The original version of the map was pretty simple, being little more than a cute recreation of the childhood home of its creator. However, when the updated version was posted on March 3rd of 2023, it wasn't long before people started to realize that there was something wrong. Firstly, despite the creator stating that the map had roughly 10 minutes of playtime, the compressed PK3 file for the map was a little over 66 megabytes. That sounds pretty small, right? Well, for perspective, the file size for the original Doom was just under 2.5 megabytes. My house is almost 30 times that size, despite its compression. Furthermore, clicking the download link on the forum doesn't actually lead you to the WAD, but rather to a Google Drive with the PK3 version of the map along with some other seemingly unrelated files. Clicking through the directory will take you to a copy of the map, under which is a text file which contains some copyright information, the contact info for the developer, and a very clear exhortation not to play the PK3 version of the map.
I tried to delete this map, but it continues to change and evolve without any input from me. What began as a tribute to a lost friend has consumed my entire life. As this map grew beyond what I created, I suffered paranoia and insomnia. It consumed me. Don't let it consume you as well. Delete it. Do not credit me. Do not try and contact me. Do not attempt to use the material for commercial purposes. Do not remix, transform, or build upon the material. Above all, do not distribute this file, modified or otherwise. I tried to keep it from the internet, but it found its way online. It's still changing. It wants you to feel sad, alone, desperate. Don't let it win. Don't play it.
So here we are on the PK3 version of the map. My House does a really good job of selling itself as advertised for the first 5 minutes or so of gameplay. It really plays like the usual sort of Doom map you might find on the forums. You travel around the house, collecting key cards and killing enemies. There are a lot of so-called Doom cutes, assets created for the map by the mapper for you to discover. I really like these because they add a fun, personal touch to exploring the house. It makes it feel a lot more real. Like you're actually getting a glimpse into the creator's life. It's not long before some weird things start to become apparent. The map starts to give you the runaround for the keys needed to move forward, but if you set outside of the house to search, you won't be able to return to the house again. Don't get me wrong, you can still go back inside, but this is now a different house, and there's something very wrong with this one. Turning to re-enter the building will bring you face to face with enemies you killed only minutes ago, now resurrected to try and end you once more. Some new paths have opened up, such as a stairway that leads to an attic area. Here, you can find a blue skull key that's needed to escape the level, along with what appears to be a large, covered mirror. Interacting with the mirror will uncover it, but the reflections don't seem to match up quite right. There's some sort of orb visible through the mirror that doesn't actually exist. While concerning, the creepy mirror only reinforces that which you already know. The faster you can get out of here, the better. Fighting your way through the house will allow you to find the keys you need, only for the doors that they open, doors that are absolutely necessary to disappear without a trace. Bizarre, impossible geometry will start to appear in the map, and things will generally become quite a bit more disorienting. The sounds in the second house are different too, as the music has been replaced by an altered version of the original music from Doom. The map even goes so far as to play a Discord notification sound exactly 10 minutes into your playthrough, just to drive home the sense you're going crazy. These are some of the key features of what players call the second house. This map, the one you're currently trapped in, has a single goal in mind: cruelty. But don't worry, I'm here to help you. Step by step. While the mod was originally posted in March, the story actually begins much further back, in August of 2022, with the death of Thomas Allard, the creator of My House. Yes, the creator of the map died months before its release, which would normally be the end of the story. This story is far from normal, however. The map had been stored on a 3.5-inch floppy disk hidden amongst Tom's things, which his family passed along to a familiar face from Tom's childhood, our protagonist, Steve Nelson. For a time, the disk sat untouched in a box of Tom's things. After all, most people in 2023 don't really have floppy drives just laying around. Still, Steve searched through his friend's belongings, beginning with Tom's sketchbook. He found many drawings of a far darker nature than he expected, with several depicting scenes of death and other disturbing imagery. It was a side of Tom that Steve wasn't aware of. Shaken by this, Steve decided to set the book aside and to focus on the stack of floppy disks that he'd been given. He ordered a floppy drive, and when Steve began to search through the files on the disk, he came across an early, unfinished version of My House. Steve and Tom had a history of creating maps together in the early 2000s, but had never published any of their work. Now, to honor the memory of his friend and the game that they had bonded over, Steve would polish up the rough edges of the map and release it to the public, sharing the last thing that he and his friend had ever built together. This decision would send Steve cascading into the depths of misery and despair. This is where the nightmares began. The details that I've shared so far have been coming from a journal that was shared on the Doom forums along with the actual map. Steve's journal, like My House itself, starts out with an appearance of normalcy. Their first few entries discuss Steve's feelings surrounding Tom's passing, his experiences discovering the map on the floppy disk, and his vow to finish the project. After Steve begins working on the map, however, he starts to suffer from surreal nightmares, each more disturbing than the last.
August 29th, 2022. I had the strangest dream last night about my childhood friend, who recently passed away. We were playing Legos in his basement like we used to do as kids, and when I turned around, he was gone. The house was empty and silent. Everything was so quiet and still. I started to smell smoke and hear screams from upstairs. I ran upstairs, and when I got there, the house was just a burned frame. Smoke was getting thicker and thicker, and I could barely see or breathe. I searched for my friend, but I couldn't find him anywhere. I couldn't see anything. I started to panic, and then I found myself outside in the fog. I was alone, but I could hear low growls in the distance. When I woke up, I wished so badly that it was all just a dream, but I knew deep down that it was real. I miss my friend so much, and it's hard to think that he's gone. There's nothing worse than letting your mind dwell on something. After a while, it starts to consume you. Just now, I decided to order a replacement set of smoke detectors with CO2 sensors, just in case.
As if reading about these nightmares wasn't bad enough, you get to experience these same horrors within the map itself, whether by Steve's intentional design or via some psychic link. His fears have been made manifest within the house. In any case, I would caution you not to take everything he says at face value. Burning down the house requires the player to complete what is, for this map, a relatively simple sequence of tasks. While continuing the journey into the second house, players will begin to find several artifacts lying around the rooms, the first of which being a can of Pepsi.
Where's all the peepus?
Which is hidden inside an impossible room.
Peepus room.
These artifacts are just fun little Easter eggs for the player to find lying around. Oh, but also some of them are absolutely essential to being able to progress in the story and achieve certain endings, but not all of them are important. And oh yeah, did I mention that this mod has multiple endings and several of them are extremely hard to get and it requires hours of work and took weeks of experimentation on the part of the community to discover them and find out which of the items are needed to achieve the best ending and which ones are just red herrings, which do absolutely nothing, are really just Easter eggs, but still add to the overall tone and narrative of the experience, so you have to find them all as well to get the full story. Yeah, so after you pick up the peepus, you can access a new room with a Bauhaus style. In this room, you can retrieve a milkshake, which serves as another essential item. From here, travel down into the basement to reveal a hidden room behind a bookshelf. Inside, there's a breaker box, which has obviously been damaged pretty majorly, judging by the sparks it's giving off. Interacting with it causes this to happen. The basement will go completely dark, and monsters will spawn throughout the house. This is a representation of the burned house from Steve's nightmare. Just like the nightmare, it starts out in the basement of the house, and by the time you get upstairs, it's already too late. The entire house is already a charred mess, and it's swarming with some absolutely hideous enemies. Exploring the rooms of the first floor will reward the player with the ruined versions of three artifacts that could have helped you to progress, but now they only serve to guide you deeper into the nightmare. Returning to the basement after collecting all three ruined artifacts will allow you to travel to yet another version of the house, this time created in a brutalist architectural style. Every surface replaced by unornamented gray concrete and hard edges. It gives a harsh, inhuman sort of atmosphere that's almost reminiscent of the Backrooms. Oh hey, the Backrooms! Yeah, as you'll continue to see, this mod draws really heavily from some of the most popular ideas in modern horror, foremost among them being the use of liminal spaces. This idea has become so prevalent in media that I really struggle to get through a video without mentioning the idea, and I'm not complaining. It's a lot like a couple of years ago when we all became obsessed with the uncanny valley. A lot of us love horror for its philosophical and psychological elements, so the more creators out there putting their own spin on liminal and uncanny horror, the better. The brutalist section is the first in many points of this mod where you see the environment take a dramatic shift away from the aesthetic of the first house. Somehow, the transformation you see now is even more of a radical departure than the house being torched. One of the most notable features of the Brutalist house is the presence of two dogs, the first of which is this German Shepherd who's just a real cutie pie and a good boy. I want to say that the second dog is some sort of schnauzer, but I'm not no dog scientist, so I can't say for sure. Anyway, he's a little meaner and kinda not so nice. You encounter both dogs in the space analogous to the house's living room, but which dog appears is determined by the size of your character. You see, going through certain doors and crossing over certain lines within the Brutalist house will cause your perspective to grow and shrink accordingly. This is a really small detail, and one that you could feasibly miss if you aren't paying attention, but it has a subtle effect on the way you perceive the map. If you enter the living room while you're larger, you'll find the good dog. He won't attack and will instead happily come up to you and just be a chill little dude. However, if you enter the living room when you're shorter, you'll almost immediately get Adam Warlocked by the bad dog. This is Doom, so your first instinct is going to be to start blasting. The bad dog has 3,000 hit points, so it'll take a bit of effort to kill it, but it is doable. And boy, once you do, have you got one heck of a reward coming your way.
Crippling depression.
If you return to the other living room after killing the bad dog, you'll find the corpse of the good dog. Turns out, there's only one dog, The change in its appearance was just a matter of perspective, and killing either of the dogs will instantly kill its counterpart. It also means that you can kill the bad dog with basically no effort by just killing the good dog, but this initiates the crushingly difficult challenge mode where you have to beat the level while totally blinded by your own tears. This, combined with the size-changing mechanic, makes me think that this is supposed to be representative of the experience many people have with dogs and animals growing up. For a small child, an encounter with a large, powerful dog, like a German Shepherd, could be a frightening or traumatic experience if the dog becomes aggressive. However, as we get older, things which once frightened us are put into their proper perspective, and we learn to coexist. In my house, that's why the dog loses its monstrous qualities when you encounter it after becoming larger. You didn't just grow physically, you matured. Unfortunately, while adulthood brings some small comfort from the fears of youth, it also exposes the individual to novel hells, incomprehensible to the budding mind of a child. We'll come to these horrors in time, but for now, let's wrap up our explanation of the dread halls of the Brutalist House. There are three artifacts to be found here, but as I mentioned earlier, they do you little good now that you've burned down the house, so, nice going, I guess. Anyway, the three artifacts are a can of tuna, a frisbee, and this cursed pumpkin. There are three more secrets here that you'll find super interesting, but they aren't necessary to progress. I promise to share more the next time you're wandering these concrete halls, but now, make your way to the bathroom section of the Brutalist House. This version of the bathroom has a tub that seems to extend pretty far down, so obviously, you've got to jump in and see if you die. Yo, what? So at the bottom of the tub, you find yourself in some sort of parking garage? It's set up in such a way that no matter how long you walk up or down the ramp, you'll never get anywhere. The garage is almost completely empty, but there is a single car.
Wow.
Take a good look at it. It will become important later. So, after you've spent an hour or two walking in circles, you may eventually say, "Screw this, I'm out," and try to leave the same way you came in. Luckily for you, attempting to leave the garage will lead you into an area resembling an airport terminal. Wandering around the terminal for a while, you'll find both men and women's restrooms. The men's room is pretty normal, but there's an empty pill bottle you can pick up in the entrance to the women's room. Aside from that, the women's room is also pretty normal. I mean, I think this is normal. When the room fills with blood, the entrance disappears and the bathroom demons come out. I'm sure the ladies watching all know about the bathroom demons. I wish us guys got bathroom demons. We just get urinals. Once they're all dead, you can return to the entrance to collect a now full bottle of pills and return to exploring the terminal. Oddly enough, the signs indicating which restroom is which have been switched, and both restrooms have returned to normal. Venturing deeper into the airport, you'll eventually come across a plane that you can board. Of course, you'll be the only passenger, but... wait, something about this feels off. No? Just me? Well, with no one else around, you'll have to fly the plane yourself. Make your way up to the front of the plane and interact with the controls in the cockpit. This will cause the plane to take off and will spawn in several weak enemies to come attack you. You're able to explore the plane freely, so make your way back to the open door at the back of the cabin. There's nothing left to do in the plane, so summon all the courage you require and step out. Now, as you're careening to your death below, suddenly... hang on. Seriously, something's off here. I know I've seen this scene on the plane before. Where was it? Pictures? No. A sketchbook? No, not there either. Ah, yes, here we go. Okay. I knew something was up. This is another one of Steve's nightmares.
January 14th, 2023. Last night, I had a nightmare that felt so real, I can still feel the fear and terror coursing through me as I write this. I was on an airplane, and I was the only passenger. I looked out the window to see the ground below and noticed that the terrain was unfamiliar. I had no idea where I was or where I was going. Suddenly, the plane started to shake violently, and I heard a loud noise coming from the engine. In the distance, I could see a huge storm cloud coming towards me. I tried to communicate with the pilot, but I couldn't hear him over the sound of the engine. The plane began to dive, and suddenly I felt a huge jolt. I looked out the window again and saw that the plane was heading for some kind of structure. I closed my eyes and felt the plane crash. I felt the impact and heard the screams and cries from people around me, and then I woke up, my heart pounding and my body drenched in sweat.
Rather than hitting the ground, you'll find yourself safe and sound within the upstairs bedroom of the burned-out house. A quick look around the house will reveal that a lot of time has passed, enough for the charred frame of the house to become cold and overgrown. The exterior doors are back too, so you're free to leave. The moment you step outside, your time in the house has come to an end. You can progress forward through the gate to leave the map, but turning around to face the house will reveal that it has completely vanished, replaced by a for sale sign posted by Navidson Realty. Anyway, there's nothing left to do here, so it's finally time to venture out of this nightmare. Hooray! You're free! You've officially conquered myhouse.wad. I mean, you missed the level's one and only secret, but that's probably not a big deal, right? Stepping onto the teleporter will lead to Doom 2's second stage, Underhalls. Treat this like a victory lap. You've earned it. You can even collect the super shotgun in this level as a trophy, an icon of success. Good job, you! Finally, if you manage to complete this level, you can move on to the third Well, that's probably not good. Yeah, so maybe this isn't the victory lap I made it out to be. It's worth telling you that you missed quite a lot on our first trip through the house. I mean, goodness, you didn't even meet Shrek yet. But there's one detail from our last journey that I want to return to, the for sale sign posted in the yard when the house disappears. My House is a project that wears its influences on its sleeve, and this is arguably the most important reference in the entire mod. Navidson Realty is a reference to the Navidson record from the book House of Leaves. It should be noted that House of Leaves is not just a book, but rather an extremely ambitious multimedia narrative that was constructed and assembled by its author, Mark Z. Danielewski, over the span of a decade. The Navidson Record is a fictional documentary that serves as one facet of an absurdly expansive and confusing story. It details the experiences of a family whose house seems to be at odds with the very fabric of reality. The interior begins to warp into all sorts of impossible structures, the most famous of which being the so-called 5.5-minute hallway, an eye-rottingly dark series of illogical, disjointed passages that extend off into space that doesn't exist. The Navidson report eventually concludes after the house simply dissolves and vanishes from existence. It should be noted that House of Leaves is not a story itself, but a compilation of the Navidson Record documentary as covered by a man named Zampano. Zampano then died, leaving his unfinished manuscript hidden under a floorboard, which was then discovered by a man named John, who is driven mad by the manuscript. This has all received extensive annotations and edits on the behalf of a group of anonymous editors. To say that there are layers does no justice to the literary labyrinth contained within the pages of the book. I've even seen a theory that the book itself is a manifestation of the house from the Navidson record, a literal house of paper leaves, complete with its confusing, unnavigable passages that the mind struggles to understand. My own personal experience with this book started at a little independent bookstore near me called Barnes & Noble. They were running a deal on horror books, so I decided to flip through what they had. Most of the offerings were pretty plain, Stephen King and the like, but one book piqued my interest. I'd heard the name before, but didn't know much about it, so I cracked it open to try to get a feel for what it was all about, and wow. Nothing will prepare you for the first time you get your hands on a copy of House of Leaves. There's a sort of childlike wonder the moment your eyes hit the page. Exploring the book is very tactile and requires flipping it end over end over end, ferociously fanning through sparsely populated pages and darting from footnote to footnote, chapter to chapter, chasing a plot that always seems to evade understanding. How could someone even write something like this? It's almost unfathomably complex. Yet, in spite of the way its construction inspires wonder, It's also a bit sickening to look at. Somehow, holding a copy of the book feels wrong, like holding some sort of cursed object, like the story itself threatens to breach into reality. I get that same feeling from playing My House. It's massively beyond the scope of this video to dive into all of the insane intricacies of how House of Leaves is written, but I hope it's clear how it relates to the mod. There's one last detail I want to touch on that's particularly relevant. Every usage of the word house throughout the entire book is written in blue text to contrast and draw your attention. It gives the very concept of the house a sort of cosmic, unshakable presence. This exact same trick is used in Steve's journal and achieves a very similar effect. MyHouse.WAD recreates the contrasting sense of wonder and horror that House of Leaves is so deeply committed to. It's a story that, despite being so obscured and difficult to navigate, feels like it's desperately clawing its way out of the world of fiction, fighting to become real. The house is not a home. It's an actor in the story, a hostile agent in Steve's life. He tried to warn you, after all. It found its way online. It's still changing. It wants you to feel sad, alone, desperate. Don't let it win. Don't play it. But you're already in too deep to quit here. The time for caution is past. If you want out of this nightmare, you have to see it to the end. You have to fight back. It's nice to think that we might be able to beat the house at its own game, but it kind of feels like we exhausted all of our options last time we went through the house. How are we actually supposed to win? Well, we've got to start to think outside of the box here. And you know what that means.
That's right, we're gonna cheat.
While most of the cheats that would actually help you to break the level have been disabled, that isn't to say that attempting to use them won't be advantageous for us. Many of the cheats have had their activation text changed, so that instead of supplying you with a tangible benefit, they instead give you hints about how to progress. For example, inputting IDFA into the console would normally give you ammo for all of your weapons, but now it gives you a hint about grabbing the super shotgun from underhauls. You've already done that, so let's see what else we can glean. IDDQD on, the command which enables God mode, displays this message. My reflection winked at me. I covered the mirror in the attic just to be safe. Kinda weird, but okay. How about if we turn God mode back off? There's no good outcome from a house fire. Gotcha. Seems obvious, but let's try to avoid the house fire on this loop. One last hint for now. ID Behold will tell you that the living room painting hides a clue if you find all the artifacts. So this time, collect all the artifacts that you can. This picture frame in the living room will catalog which of the necessary artifacts you've collected thus far, since, remember, not all of the artifacts are actually helpful for progressing. Looking at you, Pumpkin Rick. These hints give you a good sense of direction for taking a step forward in the level. So let's get back up to the point where we could initiate the house fire. Traveling back up into the attic, we come to the covered mirror. But now, we know that it's important because of the cheat message hint. Uncover the mirror and, yeah, still nothing really happens. But one thing that's particularly strange about this hint is that it seems to be a callback to an entry from the journal.
December 18th, 2022. I was in the bathroom, standing in front of the mirror, shaving. As I looked at my reflection, I noticed it winked at me. It was so strange and unexpected that I threw my razor at the mirror. I was so scared, I expected the mirror to shatter, but instead, it stayed intact. I was even more surprised when I put my hand through the mirror, and I could feel the glass. I kept going, and I was able to climb all the way into the mirror. It was like a tunnel. When I looked back, I saw myself in the mirror, and this time, I winked back. It was so surreal, but I felt like I belonged there. There was something comforting about being in the mirror, like it was my home. I woke up feeling so confused and shocked. I still can't believe it was just a dream.
Cryptic though it may be, This entry hides another hint about how to progress. Travel to the bathroom and look into the mirror. Look deep into the mirror. Look so deeply into the mirror that you accidentally parkour your way up the toilet onto the counter and through it. Welcome to the mirror world, kiddo. Or maybe this is the real world and we've been in the mirror world the whole time. Nah. The mirror world, just like we saw in the attic mirror, is subtly different from the unmirrored world. All of the sounds are reversed, and there are a few more artifacts that you can discover. In the kitchen, you can find a bottle of wine which you can collect. Stepping back into the living room from here, you'll find a picture frame that matches the artifact tracking frame in the normal house, except this one won't display any of the artifacts from the unmirrored reality. Instead, there's an entirely new set of artifacts that you need to fill up this frame. Better start collecting. Luckily for you, two more artifacts are nearby. The first being the small orb that we could see through the attic mirror, which turns out to be a Christmas ornament. How nice. On the other side of the room, you'll find another artifact hidden in a baby's crib. It's a milk bottle. Collecting it will display the message, "It wasn't meant to be." Once again, this seems to be in reference to a journal entry, but I'll save that surprise until we get through the next step in the sequence. I'd hate to spoil the surprise. Now, we've completed everything that the mirror world has to offer. Unless you'd like to leave the stage. That's right, you can just leave right now if you want. It takes you to a mirrored version of Underhalls, which will in turn spit you back out into the mirror house when you finish the level. There's very little reason to do this, so it's best to just leave through the bathroom mirror. When you do, you'll notice a trail of colorful plastic balls scattered across the floor, creating a trail to one of the bedroom closets. Following this trail will lead you to a bright yellow slide that leads down into what should be just like the ground. If you choose to jump in, you'll tumble through the darkness before landing in a large ball pit. Once you've regained your bearings, you'll realize that you've ended up somewhere entirely different from the basement, and there's a strange, sinister air about the place. This abandoned daycare, which should be alive with the joyous sounds of childhood innocence, has fallen deathly quiet. Perhaps your biggest concern ought to be the fact that there's no way back up the slide to the house. Wherever this daycare is, you're stuck here. Peering out through the entrance, you'll see a car parked outside. It should look familiar to you, because it's the same car that you encountered earlier in the endless parking garage. I really appreciate this section of the mod. It's a very niche fear to play on, but I personally experienced a lot of fear and anxiety in daycare, so this taps into fears that I had locked away a long time ago, like some sort of negative nostalgia. It's yet another example of my house including a very specific type of horror and executing it perfectly. Just like the Brutalist house, this area plays with your character's scale. Useful items are placed just out of reach to emulate the experience of being a child reaching for something on a high shelf. It's a futile effort, but you can't help but try. Don't let these tricks hold you up for too long, however, because you've got work to do here. There are more artifacts hidden in the daycare, a baseball and a pack of crayons. Things which should rightfully be used and enjoyed, but now lay untouched in this memory of a nightmare. Collecting the crayons will allow you to exit the daycare into a small playground area where you'll find one final artifact, a small stuffed rabbit sitting on a swing at the far side of the park. But keep your wits about you. You aren't alone. After a long and arduous fight, you'll finally be rewarded. Sift through the remains of Shrek's atomized corpse to retrieve the gate key and proceed through the gate. You'll find a pair of doors that seem very out of place, and upon passing through them, you'll be back in a closet of the house. This is, of course, impossible. But did you really expect anything else from this mod after what you've been through? Having escaped from the daycare, I think it's about time we read that journal entry.
November 4th, 2022. I had an incredibly vivid dream last night. This has been happening for several weeks now, so I feel I should start documenting them. I'll do my best to recall the events of my dreams. I awoke in a cold sweat, my heart pounding in my ears. I felt a chill run down my spine, and I knew something was wrong. I lay in bed, too afraid to move, when I heard a faint, ghostly cry coming from the attic. I had heard this sound before, but this time it was louder and more insistent. I tried to ignore it, telling myself it was just my imagination, but the more I tried to push it away, the louder it became. I had no choice but to investigate. I got out of bed and slowly crept up the stairs to the attic, my heart pounding so hard I thought it would burst. As I entered the attic, I noticed a trail of children's toys leading out the window. I followed the trail, feeling a strange compulsion to do so. The trail led me to an abandoned daycare center near the edge of town. I stayed back, afraid to enter, but I couldn't help but feel drawn to the place. I knew something was waiting for me inside, something dark and dangerous. I took a deep breath and stepped inside. The place was dark and silent, but as I walked around, I noticed the walls were covered in eerie drawings of children and babies. Then I heard the sound of a baby crying again, coming from the back of the room. I followed the sound, and when I reached to the back of the room, I saw a crib with a stillborn baby inside. I felt a chill run down my spine as I realized what was haunting me. The stillborn baby was the one in the attic. I backed away slowly, my heart pounding in my ears. I knew I had to leave this place, and I quickly ran out of the door, never looking back.
This is one of the most confusing entries to me for two primary reasons. Firstly, because of that second to last line, the stillborn baby was the one in the attic. The one in the attic? Steve, buddy, you never mentioned a stillborn baby in the attic. I would have remembered a stillborn baby in the attic. I'm assuming that this is referring to the milk bottle that we found in the crib, but that really only brings up more questions. Because here's the thing, there is no crib in the real world, and this journal entry was written over a month before Steve traveled through the mirror. How would he know about the crib in the attic? Beyond that, why is the mirror world a place that exhibits any differences at all? That's not very mirrorly of it. You would expect things to be the same on both sides of the mirror if one was a true reflection of the other, but instead it almost seems like a different universe. A way the world might have been. A way the world wasn't meant to be. All of this is giving me a splitting headache, but let's just keep...
No, I'm not going any further.
What?
You heard me. I am done.
You don't want to continue.
That's right.
But there's so much left to...
I don't care. This is too much for me.
You know what? Fine. I think a break might be in order. But you know what helps me to relax? Drawing a nice, warm bath. Look, you've even got a friend to join in. Say hello to Mr. Duck. I think you should give Mr. Duck a hug, but right now, he's a little out of reach. You can fill up the tub by traveling around the house and filling up each of the sinks. Each one raises the water level of the bath by a couple of inches until, finally, you can scramble up into the tub to grab Mr. Duck. Be sure to hold him nice and tight, because things are about to become uncomfortable.
November 23rd, 2022. I was actually able to get some sleep last night. However, I continue having these vivid, cryptic dreams, and they keep feeling more personal and unsettling. I'm starting to prefer the tiresome days to my dreams. I was dreaming about taking a nice, hot bath. I felt myself sinking deeper and deeper into the warm water until I couldn't breathe. I tried to scream, but no sound escaped my lips. I was drowning in my own bathtub. Suddenly, I felt a jolt, as if I had been pulled out of the water. When I opened my eyes, I found myself in a subterranean cave, illuminated by a faint, eerie blue light. I could feel a chill in the air, and I could hear the echoing of demons in the distance. I tried to scream, but my voice was muffled by the darkness of the cave. I felt a chill run down my spine as I realized I was being hunted by something unseen. I heard the scraping of claws on the rocks and felt the ground shaking beneath me. I was terrified, and I started to run. I ran and ran until I found a small crevice in the wall of the cave. I squeezed through it and hid in the darkness, hoping the demons wouldn't find me. Eventually, I awoke in my own bed, safe and sound, but I couldn't help but feel a lingering fear that the demons were still out there, watching and waiting.
Sorry for tricking you, but I'm pretty sure you wouldn't have voluntarily drowned yourself. Not without the promise of getting snuggly with Mr. Duck. Besides, somehow I had to flood the house for you to continue. If you're going to act paralyzed and indecisive, I've got no choice but to make the decision for you. I told you that I would help you, step by step. Even if that means I've got to take the steps for you when you're acting like a coward. Goodness, that is a lot more water than I thought it'd be. Maybe I should have. Well, it's too late now. With the house flooded, you can finally access the next zone, the bathhouse. Trudge back down into the basement and wander around for a bit. Eventually, the geometry of the house will start to break again, and you'll find yourself here, amidst the aquatic ambience of pools and steam. Once again, keep your wits about you. You aren't alone. No, it isn't Shrek this time. Just like in Steve's nightmare, this place is haunted by something unseen. Strange, invisible enemies pursue you endlessly through the bathhouse. They aren't intangible or invincible. You can kill them, but good luck gunning them down if you can't even locate them. It's easy enough to outrun them, so probably best you keep moving. Stay still for too long, and they might just... Once again, we've got some really clear inspiration from the backrooms here, or more specifically, the so-called pool rooms. Yet another example of just how broad the scope of influence for this mod is. Of course, just like the Brutalist house, the daycare, or even the airport, this is essentially a reskin of the house. The layout of the bathhouse is more or less the same, minus some glaring differences, such as the murder ghosts chasing you, and the fact that some rooms have been replaced by a seemingly infinite maze of dark, steamy locker rooms. A maze that you're gonna have to navigate if you want to leave. Sorry again. It takes some serious trial and error to move forward as the locker room seems to shift around you, fighting to keep you trapped inside. After some time exploring, you'll come across this area with a massive swimming pool. Look, there's another friend in the pool. That makes up for me tricking you, doesn't it?
Not even a little.
You don't want to be friends with the fish? Well, I didn't realize you were so opposed to having friends who love you. Now look what you've done. You hurt the poor fish girl's feelings, and she's becoming irate. Jumping into the water will cause the fish to immediately begin trying to rip you limb from limb. Shooting it won't help you either, because the moment the fish dies, she'll spawn in a dozen babies who are equally vengeful about your rejection of their mother. Maybe next time you have the opportunity to make a friend, you won't cast them aside so thoughtlessly. In any case, there's an artifact at the bottom of the pool which you'll want to collect. It's a 20-sided die, and right next to it is a cleverly hidden path that will lead you to a series of watery tunnels. There are a couple of vertical shafts where you can swim up and catch your breath, but only one of them will allow you to swim high enough to breach the water. The other is simply a trap to make you waste breath, but if you run out of breath, you'll simply
keel over and die.
If you manage to successfully navigate the tunnels, you'll arrive at a hideously distorted version of the garage. Peering out through the hole in the side of the room will show nothing but sky below and demons in the distance. Now, I know what I said about making friends, but based on the fact that they're already shooting at you, I'd say that ship has sailed. I'm sure they've been in contact with Miss Fish, and she's already told them all about the scumbag that broke her heart. That's you, by the way. There are a couple of things to do here, and to do either of them, you'll need to traverse the floating platforms. Once you get halfway through, however, several more demons will spawn in and attempt to chase you off the platform. Do your best to avoid getting blasted off, and make your way across the invisible path that leads to the wedding ring artifact. Then, by leaving through the door on the far end of the bridge, you'll have reached the Brutalist house without initiating the house fire. Once again, you'll want to gather all of the artifacts here to ensure that nothing important gets missed. I promised you before that I would expose the rest of this area's secrets to you during your next trip through the house, so here we go. The first is this small yellow room that you can reach by doing some creative maneuvering. Making your way to this area, you'll find a television with a cord that you can interact with. Interacting with it unplugs the cord and... What did you do? Did you break something? Can't you just, I don't know, press some buttons, twist some knobs, that sort of thing? You're the one in control here. Oh. Good. It looks like you were able to plug it back in by hitting the use key. But now there's something wrong with the TV. Actually, now there's something wrong with every TV. Literally any TV that you can find is going to display this exact same thing, even the ones in the mirror world. This doesn't really do anything as far as I know, but it's a bit of a strange detail. This map is full of red herrings and dead ends. Paths which seem like they must be important, like you have to deal with them, but they're just totally pointless. This does, however, give us the perfect opportunity to explore the next secret in the area. You might find the secret another way, such as if you fall off the bridge in the sky room, but most players encounter it here. You see, there's no way for you to get back up to where you jumped from. Your only choice is to jump into the dark pit below, which leads you to the endless stairwell. In a similar manner to the parking garage, you can go down for as long as you want, but you'll never reach the bottom. The same goes if you try to travel upstairs, it just keeps going. So the only logical solution? Initiate a backwards long jump maneuver so that you can reach the final stage, defeat Bowser, and save Peach. Wait, sorry, wrong game. Yeah, there's actually nothing you can do here. There's a door that will lead you back to the house, but the staircase is just a staircase. I specifically think this is really interesting because it reminds me a lot of SCP-087, the Endless Staircase. This mod is almost constantly referring to other horror projects. The walls and corridors are a veritable love letter to the genre. But this isn't even the coolest or most direct homage within the map. Honestly, I think there are two equally mind-blowing references that end up tied for first place, and you haven't seen either of them. We'll get to those shortly. Don't worry. Once you've returned to the house, we can talk about the final secret. Sort of. You can see the secret pretty clearly the first time you go to the Brutalist Maze. It's a teleporter on the far side of the gap. The only issue is, you can't actually reach it yet. I know. I told you that I'd let you in on all the secrets, but you'll have to forgive me on this one account. Here, I'll give you a consolation prize before you move on. Go to the cheats and type in the noclip command, ID clip on. This will display another hint message for you, reading, "Be careful not to clip out of reality in the wrong areas." That's pretty cool, right? That's a pretty overt reference to the original Backrooms post from 2019. Man, things sure have changed since then. Probably best we heed its warning and turn noclip back off. Better safe than sorry. Jump back down the bathtub and return to the airport. This time, you can go to the women's room and, if you leave the entrance to the restroom clear of blood, you can collect a BFG for your trouble. It's about the closest thing Doom 2 has to a nuke launcher, and you'll need it later. It's also worth mentioning that you can find our good friend, Mr. McQueen, wow, parked outside again. Aside from that, there's very little to do in the airport, and good thing too. You've got a plane to catch.
February 26th, 2023. I can no longer tell what elements of this map are my friends, which are mine, and what the map has created. I am no longer afraid that the map is creating itself. It needs me as much as I need it. I'm not sleeping much, but I recall this dream with surprising clarity. I was standing on a beach, staring out at the placid water, the ocean stretching out as far as the eye could see. Seagulls cawed overhead, and the gentle caress of water lapped the sand in front of me. I dipped my toes into the water, at least I tried. There was no water. No ocean. It was an illusion. I realized everything around me was fake.
Now begins the procession towards the end. Towards finality. Towards happiness. There's only one thing left to do. In the living room, there's a painting that will direct you to your final destination, a hole in the fence behind the house. Thankfully, the front door has returned, and you can now return to the backyard. Follow the fence line along to the point where the painting showed the gap and interact with it. This will cause a secret passageway to open, and stepping through it will lead you to the interstate? Okay. I guess I don't know everything about this map. Just look around, see if anything seems weird. Is that the same car that's been following us this whole time? What's it doing here? I doubt whoever it was is going to be following us anymore. That looks like a pretty nasty accident. What's that light through the tree line? Well, I suppose it makes sense for there to be a gas station all the way out here. Wait, what? You're going inside the Hell Station?
Yes, I am.
Where's that coward I had to trick into the bathhouse? Can't we just...
No.
Hold on. Okay, be reasonable. We have no idea what's... Ugh. Fine. Have it your way. Suppose I deserve it. The interior seems barren, but not quite abandoned. Just like everyone left in a hurry.
Why did the map lead us here? There must be a reason.
An Atari controller, huh? I guess that makes sense. You were missing one of the artifacts for the Mirror World item frame. In that case, the last thing to check here would be the bathroom. You know, the one with the trail of blood leading to it. Are you sure you want to do this? Well, that was anticlimactic. It's just an ordinary bathroom. Except that when you step inside, you'll probably realize that this is one of the bathrooms from the house. And when you step out... Yeah, I'm really starting to wonder if we're ever going to get out of here. I hope I didn't... I'm sorry if I... You know I just wanted to help you, right? Well, we got the controller. May as well check the Mirror World one last time. It looks like there might be a gas station in the Mirror World too. Let's go back to the fence. The interstate is much darker here. And the car from before is gone. We can return to the gas station, but there's not much to find. I mean, there's a rocket launcher, but that's not really why we're here. Probably best to grab it, just in case. After that, what, you just hit the road again? You already walked up and down the road for ages. It's just like the parking garage, just like the stairs, just like this whole rotten loop. Around and around and around, never getting anywhere. Until Finally, you see it. The trail of smoke, winding its way up into the sky. So meager, you'd be forgiven for thinking that was the end of things. Following this trail of smoke leads you to a tiny clearing with the dying embers of a burned-out campfire right in the center. Next to it, a tree with a heart and initials carved into it. S and A. Well, S might be Steve. Who the heck is A? Whatever. Doesn't matter.
There was no happiness to be found. I wandered the set only to find myself staring into oblivion. It was the end of time itself. No joy, no misery, no sadness, only emptiness.
Well, is that it then? To become all this way, to witness the final dregs of a dying fire? Pathetic. What is that warmth? Is this really it? Is this the end of the level? A fake beach. All of that. Collecting all those artifacts, iteration after iteration of the house, loop after loop, and all for... No. No, I can accept this. Happiness is a choice, after all, and I'm so tired of trying. I can choose to be happy with this ending. It may not be perfect, but what is? Why should I expect anything better? To aim higher is just... it's pride. If this is the hand that I've been dealt, so be it. I choose happiness.
A day passes in the void. A month. A year. 2, 5, 10. Is this an eternity? 20 years. 100 years. 1,000 years. I've sat in this room for 1,000,000 years now, entertaining the same thoughts, pondered the same questions, ruminated on every mistake in my life, anguishing over them for centuries. A 1,000,000,000 years now. Double that. I'll double it again. I'm still nowhere close to the end of eternity. I pray for death, but it never comes. Just me and my thoughts. And my mistakes, and my insecurities, and my regrets, and my loneliness.
You're still here? I'm sorry. This map does want you to be alone. I led you into the pit of madness, and why? I think it used me. I think it used me to get to you somehow. Urging you onward, deceiving you. And now, what are we even left with? A sea of nothingness so thick it swallows up the mind and vacuous waves, and the noble lie that we can find happiness even here. Once, I thought that lie was sufficient. Now I wonder what might have been. What if I had rejected the comfortable lie for an uncomfortable truth? What if happiness isn't a choice? What if...
happiness
must be fought for.
With nothing to lose and everything to gain, venture back into the house one last time. A quick run through the underhalls nets you the super shotgun, once an empty trophy of false accomplishment, now the deadly image of determination. You'll repeat every single step that you did last time. Gather the key cards, enter the second house, collect the first set of artifacts, and then it's back to the mirror world. At this point, it practically feels like we're returning home, doesn't it? The dull blue ambience of the twisted reflection almost seems to beckon us towards a fated end in the void. A fate that you're going to overthrow. Collect the artifacts here, then return to unmirrored reality. Follow the plastic balls down to the daycare, collect another set of artifacts, and conquer the fears of childhood. You are no child. You can rise above the fear and trauma to fight for your happiness. A final showdown with Shrek proves your resolve. Nothing can stop you. After this, fill up all the sinks, return to the tub, and take the plunge, this time in boldness and courage. When you resurface, wade through the flooded halls and enter the tepid pools of the bathhouse. Meet up again with your old friend, Mrs. Fish, and blow her away with a super shoddy. Toxic friends who trash talk you behind your back aren't worth your time. You're a strong, independent individual who don't need no fish lady holding you down. Give her the gat, grab the D20, and brave the watery depths before ascending to the heights of the Sky Room. A quick run across the bridge nets you the wedding ring and access to the Brutalist House. And then it's a frantic scramble to grab all of the artifacts while avoiding the jaws of the bad dog. It's nothing to you anymore. With three more artifacts under your belt, dive over the edge of the bathtub and into the parking garage, and return to the airport. Grab the BFG, and of course, the filled pill bottle. Finally, approach the boarding ramp and enter the plane. Begin the plane sequence, fight your way to the exit, and take your very last leap of faith. You're almost done. You're almost home. When you wake up in bed, don't waste any time returning to the hole in the fence. Return to the crashed car and say your goodbyes to our only consistent companion through this nightmare. The next time you meet, there will be no time for pleasantries. The gas station holds the last things you need. The Atari controller, the rocket launcher, and of course, a way home. Arm yourself with everything you can, step into the bathroom, and close the door. The rush is over. There's no need to charge blindly into what's coming. And this is your last opportunity to rest. The next step should be taken in somberness and sobriety. I can't help but recall what a journey it's been getting here. You've had to fight an awful lot, and here we are at the brink of the abyss, ready to dive back in. Only a madman leaps into the abyss without regards for his safety and sanity. But then again, we've become quite well acquainted with madness, haven't we? I think I know the perfect way for us to rest up before the end. You know I've been holding out on you, and I think it's time for me to show you the last two secrets this map has to offer. After all, you've just collected the final piece of the puzzle. Return to the basement and step into the boiler room at the bottom of the stairs. Interacting with this thing will open up a new path for you to return to the Brutalist maze. Once there, travel back to the ledge across from the teleporter pad. It's a bit of a difficult maneuver, but if you can manage it, use the rocket launcher to rocket jump across to the platform. Be super careful when doing this, because you only get one chance. If you fall into the void below at this point, you can't use the boiler room shortcut to come back to the Brutalist house. However, if you manage to make it across the gap, you can step onto the teleporter to be greeted with this. I told you it was cool. There is a full recreation of the first level of the Backrooms in here, and it is massive. It's by far the largest and most confusing space in the entire map. And once again, I get to use my favorite line. You aren't alone. No, in the back rooms, there is an entity, the Skin Stealer. You can fight back, but good luck with that. For context, you fought plenty of strong enemies in this level that had a lot of hit points. Shrek and Miss Fish had 1,000 HP, and the Bad Dog had a whopping 3,000. Heck, the Cyber Demons, one of Doom's strongest enemies, has 4,000. This entity, the Skin Stealer, has 9,999,999,999 hit points. If my math is right, shooting it constantly with the BFG for a month straight will kill it. Barely. Yeah, maybe just run away. It blew my mind the first time I saw this because it feels like the logical conclusion of the backroom's influence that you've been seeing for the entire level. Despite how endless the yellow halls may seem, it is possible to escape. Doing so will spit you back out at the endless staircase, and from there, you can return to the house. Now, I may have neglected to mention to you that you didn't actually need to do the rocket jump to cross the gap. Yeah, activating the no-clip cheat and then stepping out of bounds to leave the level will actually teleport you here as well, so I guess that warning about no-clipping out of reality in the wrong areas was serious. I suppose we could have done that ages ago, but I just thought that, you would, Anyway, for our final secret, which just might be the best one of them all, venture to the bedroom closet on the first floor and start opening and closing the door like mad. It might take a little bit because the chance of it happening is entirely random, but when it does... Oh yeah, that's spooky. This is the only area that rivals the vastness of the back rooms, and it's yet another reference to House of Leaves. This is a recreation of the infamous 5.5-minute hallway, complete with oppressive, unforgiving darkness and the endless spiral stairs. Even playing through this section of the level is nearly impossible because you just can't see anything. Notably, jumping down the center of the staircase is the only place I can recall where you can actually fall to your death in this map. Jumping down pits is usually encouraged in MyHouse.WAD, but this one kills you almost instantly. Weird. Attempting to use the stairs will get you nowhere, which I've only just realized seems to be a theme in this map. Any sort of ascension is met with either a dead end or a loop. Ultimately, you always end up where you started. Always right back where you started. I would really like to speak to you more on this. I know, this is the perfect time for you to subscribe. We're less than 100 subscribers away from 1,000. I've got several thoughts about the nature of this map, so we could just sit here chatting in the darkness for days if...
We must continue.
I suppose I'm stalling, aren't I? I'll admit, I'm terrified of returning to that campsite in the mirror world. What if nothing changes? We could end up back on that cold, lifeless beach, you know? Could your mind withstand another eternity? I guess we'll find out. Hit it. The moment you open the exit, your deadliest foe yet appears directly behind you. This creature, known as the Mirror Vile, is a pitch black monstrosity that will burn you with extremely powerful inky flames. Furthermore, at 5 million hit points, it's the most resilient enemy in the entire map besides the Skin Stealer. As soon as it spawns in, the mad dash back to the house begins. It's still no less difficult to navigate the mirror interstate, but do your best to run from the Mirror Vile and locate the exit. Clamber back through the hole in the fence and fire a few shots at the Mirror Vile to halt its pursuit. Rush through the front door, up the hallway, and back through the bathroom mirror. You're safe and sound from the Mirror Vile in the warm light of unmirrored reality. But unfortunately, the real fight is yet to come. Outside of the mirror, all manner of unholy creatures are swarming the house. An archvile meanders about the house listlessly, restoring new life and vigor to every enemy that you've defeated, waiting for you to show yourself. As soon as your presence becomes known, a wave of violence is set against you. And even once you've cleared the house, there are dozens of powerful enemies lying in wait outside. Remember, you chose this. This is how your fight for happiness begins. Your goal is to reach the gas station, so do your best to weave your way across the battlefield to the hole in the fence. You'll need to save all the ammo you can manage for what comes next. You've got one last trek up the interstate, and then it's time. The forces of hell itself have boiled over to destroy you. Like hungry lions seeking to devour your very soul, they swarm the gas station. One final blockade between you and freedom. Don't let them win. Hang in there. We are so close. How could you lose now? I trusted you, and you're just gonna give up? I thought you wanted to fight.
I'm sorry.
You're back? How can you be back? I thought you left me. I thought I was alone. I think you know what to do. You did it! And here we are, back at the end. I can't quite believe that we're almost out. Let's take this next step together. This is real. There's no lie to accept here. The truth is that you fought for this happiness on this beach with the warm glow of a sunset, a real sunset. You did what Steve couldn't. You beat the map. You fulfilled his warning to us all that time ago. It wants you to feel sad, alone, desperate. Don't let it win. Don't play it. But you did play it. Not only that, you took that desperation and you turned it into your greatest weapon. You pulled me out of the void of eternity, and you never let the house win. You won. And best of all, you aren't alone. There's one last thing we need to do before we can say this story is over. Let's say you go through this whole process, gather all the artifacts, come to the brink of victory, and then burn the whole accursed house to oblivion. You see, when I showed you the house's two last secrets earlier, I may have been telling not quite a lie, let's call it a creative truth. Because while the house might not have any more secrets for you, Steven certainly does. That dark secret I told you about right at the beginning of the video, you're about to learn it. At this point, leaving the house will once again cause it to dissolve and be replaced by the Navidson Realty sign. But what if you return to the hole in the fence? Well, that's how you get to the grave of one Steven Nelson. The QR code on this gravestone is unreadable in this state, but a community member managed to make it scannable, which reveals the obituary for Steve Nelson. That obituary reveals that Steve died on the very same day as Tom, well over a month before the very first post relating to myhouse.wad. Steve has been dead the entire time. And that just... what? How? All the files in the Google Drive are uploaded by him, or at least from his account. Who on earth wrote the journal that we've been reading this whole time? Who finished the map? Who decided to put Shrek in there? A ghost? Another person entirely? We saw that heart earlier carved into the tree. S and A. Could the journal be written by A? It never specifically says that Steve is writing the journal. I really don't know if there are exact answers to these questions. Which brings us to the ultimate contradiction of this video. I set out to explain myhouse.wad to you and to guide you through it, but I really don't know if that's possible. I know that leaving it there would be horribly disappointing, and trust me, I don't plan to disappoint you. I can walk you through the steps necessary to reach the beach at the end. I'll even do my best to analyze what we've just been through, and I will give you my theories about what's going on. But do I really feel comfortable calling that an explanation? Not after everything we've seen. How do you explain the unexplainable? It might be clear to you that this mod isn't out to give definitive answers. At every turn, experience has been prioritized over understanding. I don't subscribe to the idea that every story is subjective. Art is communication, and stories are a contract. Opening our minds to understand the author's intention is the responsibility of the audience. But with that being said, when the author has so clearly prioritized the audience as part of the narrative, how can your own journey possibly fail to shape the story at an essential level? The story of MyHouse.WAD is inexplicable, not because the author has no intention, but because the author's vision of a deeply subjective experience is vividly realized in My House's shifting walls. After all, it's right there in the name. I can never explain the story of your house. I can only help you to understand the story of my house. And I did promise you that I would help you step by step. Right? When I said at the beginning that Steve's secret changes everything, I meant it. This whole time, we've had a somewhat consistent conception of the story. To recap, Steve's childhood friend Tom passed away, leaving him an unfinished Doom map. As a tribute to his friend, Steve decided to finish the map and publish it. Over the course of development, Steve started to suffer from severe insomnia and terrible nightmares, which he blames on the map as if it were a living thing. Somehow, the contents of his nightmares begin to spill over into the mod, seemingly without Steve's involvement. Finally, after several months of working on the map, Steve decides to publish the unedited version of Tom's map, only for the PK3 version to go up in its place. However, the obituary seems to suggest that Steve Nelson could not have made the map. At the very least, both accounts can't be true in the literal sense. Dead men write no code, so they say. I suppose Steve's ghost could have finished the map and written the journal, but that feels a bit too cliche for such a detailed, intricately thought out project, so I'm ruling that out. Then again, Shrek is also in this mod, so... In any case, the obituaries also reveal a lot of important information about Steve and Tom outside of the mod. Taking either document in isolation, there's really nothing notable. However, when we start to compare them, we see a lot of startling similarities in the path they took in life. Both of them died on the same day. Both went to the same high school, moved to Illinois later in life, ran for fun, and married their high school crushes. Probably the most notable detail is that their funerals are both happening at the same parlor on the same day. The most literal and straightforward interpretation of these parallels is that they married each other and lived life together, but where else has any of this story been straightforward? No, I get the idea that there's something a little bit less normal going on here. We know that both Steve and Tom attended the same high school. They ran track, moved away for college, moved back to the same city where they married their high school crush. They also died on the same day and are having their funerals at the same time and place. Those similarities do seem to imply that their lives followed the same path because they were intertwined. But the similarities continue a bit deeper, and these couldn't be explained by choice. These are details that I haven't actually seen others mention. There are also some odd similarities between the families of the two men. Both of their fathers' names started with the same letter, Dale and Douglas. I noticed that and thought, that's kind of interesting. Writers usually avoid giving multiple characters names that start with the same letter. Then I kept looking at the obituary, and I realized that the mother's names also begin with the same letter, Judy and Julie. It's true for their sisters' names too, Suzanne and Samantha. It might seem like a stretch, but these names were all chosen by the author. Is this another red herring? I don't think so. There are two main reasons why I started to become suspicious of Tom and Steve in the first place. Back when I was first looking into this story, I saw this picture. No matter how hard I tried to shake it, there was one observation I kept returning to. I kept thinking to myself, man, these guys look really similar. Now, at first, even I thought I was grasping at straws. I mean, I'm drawing this conclusion from, what, a few character names starting with the same letter and a picture of two guys who look vaguely similar? That's textbook overanalysis. I'm probably just seeing things, right? But on subsequent journeys through the house, I started to notice a recurring theme involving the journal entry from the 18th of December. This is what really solidified this theory in my mind.
December 18th, 2022. I was in the bathroom, standing in front of the mirror, shaving. As I looked at my reflection, I noticed it winked at me. It was so strange and unexpected that I threw my razor at the mirror. I was so scared, I expected the mirror to shatter, but instead, it stayed intact. I was even more surprised when I put my hand through the mirror, and I could feel the glass. I kept going, and I was able to climb all the way into the mirror. It was like a tunnel. When I looked back, I saw myself in the mirror, and this time, I winked back. It was so surreal, but I felt like I belonged there. There was something comforting about being in the mirror, like it was my home. I woke up feeling so confused and shocked. I still can't believe it was just a dream.
How could Steve feel like he belonged in the mirror? Why was it so comforting, and why did it feel like home? There's obviously something important here, but we need to take a closer look at the mirror world to figure out what's going on. The mirror world, despite its similarities, always maintains differences from the unmirrored world. The crib in the attic, the unique artifacts, and of course, the false beach, they're all radical deviations from what we might assume to be the real world. But that's not how mirrors work. Okay, stating the obvious here, but real mirrors show an exact reflection. So, what if that isn't a mirror? That's the sort of question that only leads to more questions, but I think you deserve some answers. In this video, I've tried very hard to avoid using the term real world, because at no point through this journey have we been able to nail down what real even means with regards to this mod. At this point, I've come to the conclusion that in myhouse.wad, there is no real world, singular, but rather two equally real worlds. Two parallel universes in which nearly everything is the same, but with a few skewed details. The house is the meeting point, the singularity at which the veil between worlds thins and becomes permeable. That's why Steve and Tom's story surrounds the house, because it's the point at which their lives interact. It's the convergence of two worlds. Steve is naturally from what we might call the mirror world, and when he passes through the mirror in his nightmare, he's actually exiting the mirror, not entering it. Likewise, that would imply that Tom is passing into the mirror at this point. I think it's also worth pointing out that right before passing through the mirror, Steve is shaving, and one of the things that sets Steve and Tom's appearance apart is that Steve is clean-shaven while Tom has a beard. There's also some pretty good evidence to suggest that Steve's normal world is what we would consider to be the mirror world. In the journal, on the entry from November 4th, we get this passage.
I heard a faint, ghostly cry coming from the attic. I had heard this sound before, but this time it was louder and more insistent. I tried to ignore it, telling myself it was just my imagination, but the more I tried to push it away, the louder it became. I had no choice but to investigate. I got out of bed and slowly crept up the stairs to the attic, my heart pounding so hard I thought it would burst. As I entered the attic, I noticed a trail of children's toys leading out the window. I followed the trail, feeling a strange compulsion to do so. The trail led me to an abandoned daycare center near the edge of town. I stayed back, afraid to enter, but I couldn't help but feel drawn to the place. I knew something was waiting for me inside, something dark and dangerous. I took a deep breath and stepped inside. The place was dark and silent, but as I walked around, I noticed the walls were covered in eerie drawings of children and babies. Then I heard the sound of a baby crying again, coming from the back of the room. I followed the sound, and when I reached to the back of the room, I saw a crib with a stillborn baby inside. I felt a chill run down my spine as I realized what was haunting me. The stillborn baby was the one in the attic.
The dream takes place over a month before Steve's nightmare about the mirror, but he already knew about the crib in the attic. It's important to remember that the crib doesn't exist in the unmirrored house, but it was normal in his mind. This also implies that the details that vary from Steve's life to Tom's are a result of them living in parallel universes, two sides of a warped reflection. It's why almost everything is the same, but not quite everything. And yet, somehow, despite all of this, these two individuals are somehow connected to one another, transcendentally bonded through the barrier between worlds by, what, a Doom mod? In some sense, yes, but I think it's been made clear at this point that my house is no mere house. The map itself is transcendental, alive. Even when Steve's own mind fails him, the mod refuses to remain static. It ebbs, it flows, it generates copy after copy of itself, warped into a myriad of locations that are all the same. The brutalist maze, the baths, the airport, all of them are ultimately reflections of the house, yet all are undeniably different in some fundamental way. And somehow, this map sews together these reflections seamlessly, binding together worlds in a collage of pure reality. It's no wonder that these two men, separated by the intangible void that divides one life from another, could be bound together in friendship through this house. Two twin selves, one and the same person, separated only by the circumstances of the universe that each calls home. Yet, even so, I have no way of accounting for just how closely these two seem to be tied together. The photos of them together and the account of their friendship seems inexplicable in this narrative. Perhaps they're simply more generations of the house, which have been spat out onto Steve's hard drive only for them to make their way online seemingly by their own accord. I warned you, I don't have answers to all of these questions. Experience over understanding and all that. Maybe this whole project is simply a tangle of red herrings, intentionally designed so that every interpretation has a defeater, that every completed narrative has some contradicting evidence. But there's one final point I want to make about the materials that we've been given, and one final world that we must explore before we get to the full picture. It's the world you're in now, the real, real world. The journey doesn't end with Steve completing the map. It doesn't even end after he posted the map. Instead, the journal ended almost a week later, well after the community had gotten their hands on the PK3 file. To me, that entry is specifically included to make one point known. You are part of this story, and you have a part to play. With that in mind, let's once again go back to the beginning. This will be the last loop of the house you'll ever take. This story begins with a death. Well, maybe two deaths. I don't know, man. Those obituaries make my head hurt. And in any case, the story begins with death. And there's a common thread that seems to tie a majority of interpretations together. Grief. The focal point of the story, the house, is only accessible to us because Steve began to work on it as a way of mourning for his friend. Furthermore, regardless of the author's identity, the theme of guilt is also very present in the journal. It's also implied that Tom dealt with serious grief and depression in his life, as evidenced by the drawings in the sketchbook. I don't claim to know a lot about how this is supposed to be interpreted. I don't think anyone should, but I do understand my own experience of the map. If I have to rely on my own experience of the house to know how I fit into this narrative, so be it. As I understand it, the house itself is allegorical to grief. Having said that, I don't think I can build on this point without opening up a bit about my own experiences with grief, depression, and brokenness. The vast darkness of depression was a mental loop that I could never seem to escape. I tried to deal with my feelings alone, to hold it in, to hide it, but that left me stuck in a labyrinth of confusion. At times, I felt a sense of progress, hope, but more often, even when I was utterly certain that I was moving forward one step at a time, I would look up months later and realize that I had been standing still the whole time. My isolated perspective kept me chasing red herrings and falling down rabbit holes, rather than tracking down the real issues I was facing. I threw effort into the void, working away at things that I thought would make my life better, but I lacked the humility to admit that I might need help. Grief is the ultimate isolator, and loneliness consumes a man like a fire. I was in the sort of pit that you can't claw your way out of, not by your own might. It's a place that makes you hate hope itself. In that pit, your only salvation becomes an enemy. Asking for help and admitting my need required desperation. My weakness became a weapon for rooting out the brokenness within me. I didn't need to be stronger. I just needed help. Real help often pushes you out of your comfort zone. Real help develops understanding, and understanding reveals the road to liberation. There is a way out of the woods. It was just hidden to your pain-addled eyes. The experience of playing MyHouse.WAD parallels this pretty closely. You start out traveling through the map alone. Even though you might go through loop after loop, it would be extraordinarily difficult for an individual to fully explore and understand this map without turning to help from the community. Many people play through the first loop, get the house fire ending, and never discover the richness of experience available to them. Other players may sense that the level has more to offer and become determined to reach the true ending on their own. They spend hours in the level, chasing red herrings and falling down rabbit holes, but never really coming closer to freedom. In reality, most of what you can do in the house isn't what you need to do. The average person will give up when they come to understand how truly daunting the task is. Finally, there are those who really find success, the ones who pin down the goal, fight for happiness, and find themselves in the warm glow of the real beach. Those are the ones who are willing to admit their need for help. Some days, your fight for happiness means fighting against yourself, fighting against the stubborn assurance that you can or should be able to do it all on your own. Sometimes that's what it takes to make it onto that beach. Now, my interpretation is purposefully a little bit restrained. I'm not going to act like everyone who plays this map has the same experience I did. That's demonstrably false. Stories like this one are hard for me. I don't really like analyzing stories based on my own experience because I can't shake the feeling that I need strong evidence to draw strong conclusions. So, I just won't make any strong conclusions. Except this one. There is exactly one thing I can say about myhouse.wad with absolute certainty. This house is a house of mirrors. Your interpretation of this map reveals far more about you than it does about the story itself. The brighter the light that you shine into this deep, dark enigma of a house, the brighter the reflection upon your own face. That is the inescapable fact of myhouse.wad. I offered two different interpretations of this story to you, one literal and one experiential. I tried my best to illuminate this story for you, but from both of my explanations, I think I've only succeeded in showing you who I am. I think it's cool when stories have grand plots with lots of symbolism, and I don't like to make strong claims when I'm uncertain. I have struggled against my own futility, and it shapes the way I understand my current experiences. Sometimes, I'm afraid to ask for help, but I am terrified of being alone. None of this helps to explain whatever narrative the author saw within this monstrosity. It fails to capture the essence of the map, but I am quite sure that this is what was supposed to happen, and I'm thrilled that we got to take this journey together. Step by step. I'm Curmudgeon. Thanks for watching.